That should be recording. Awesome. So we were talking about these basic component parts, and again, I'm going to show you a bunch of these parts here momentarily. And when we talked about resistors, you're going to see resistors today. You're going to see some smaller stuff like this. Some of these smaller resistors. Again, this is a big resistor, but in most cases, they're pretty small. Resistors are going to pose flow. So imagine on a street or wherever you're at, the more police officers that are on the road, you're going to see people slowing down, right? So it's going to resist the flow of cars. This resistor will work for, it does not matter whether it's DC, direct current, which is like 9 volt batteries or stuff like that, or AC, alternating current. It works the same way. There are some nuances in it, which I'm not going to discuss this detail because you're not really concerned about those details right now. What we're trying to do is the basic concepts, okay? So it's going to resist the flow of electrons through it. When it resists something, though, when it resists, right? And if I come up and I try to push you and you resist it, we're going to have a little bit of conflict there, right? A little bit of a barrier that we're going to have, and that's going to be the power dissipation. You're going to resist my pushing you, and in that you're doing work too, right? Mm-hmm. And then there's going to be this heat dissipation. Now, I'm going to get something done, you're going to probably get something done, but there's also that confliction between us. And what happens is if we push current through this resistor, we're going to develop a potential across it, or a voltage, right? So the more current that we push through it, and we maintain the same resistance, we're going to get a higher voltage. So the more and more I push against you and you keep the same resistance, there's going to still be a greater potential developed across you. And that's what we do, right? So we're going to talk more about that, but there are some very special resistors out there. And a resistor can be very simply a bunch of wire, right? Because a wire has resistance per 100 feet. We classify it that way. If any of you guys done networking, there's a 330 feet for 100 foot or for a Cat 5 cables, what you pull. And the reason why you can only go 330 feet is because that's the distance upon which a signal degrades to a point which anything beyond that, you really can't use it. That's why we use fiber optics and stuff like that. And even then, you have certain modes of fiber optics which you can only use for certain lengths of run before you put in a amplifier, blah, blah, blah. You know, there's all these things, okay? So wire has resistance. It doesn't matter. We think it doesn't, right? You can attach wire here and over there you get voltage. Well, across a huge length of wire, you actually have voltages drops across it. So this, while it looks just like a great big piece of, it's an old Variac part, it's actually a big wiper, and as you'll see, this wiper goes around here, touches the back side here, and it shorts it, this connection here to this primary connection here. As we move it around, starts with zero resistance, right, because it's basically tied at the same point. And as you move it around, it starts allowing so much of this wire to be utilized as a resistor. So you increase that resistance until you get maximum resistance all the way across. The difference is that from this point to the other terminal at the other side, as you move it from one terminal to the other terminal, it increases in resistance from this direction, but in the opposite way, from that terminal to the other side, it decreases. Make sense? Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna pass these around. So this is a big one. And that's old. Yeah, it's old, but we use them in variable transformers and these larger variacs so we can adjust voltages. You're gonna see that same thing in different flavors in our life. And while I like to relate things to what we see daily, because this might actually show you kind of the same exact thing, it's just a smaller one, right? And you can physically see how that wiper moves around. The wiper's actually connected to this centerpiece here, and this one here would be one terminal, this would be the other terminal. As you go from one side to the other side, the resistance increases on one side, decreases up between the other two. But the resistance between those two outside terminals remains the same, right? if I measure from here to here, it would not change. There's nothing changing there. But only from that center wiper to that, those outside edges. Okay. So that's even another older one. But what's interesting is that, and here's what they typically look like. They're sealed. They're sealed, and if you hear it, you can hear that wiper action. Okay. So these are variable resistances or potentiometers. If I was to put two of these things together, we call them rheostat, which is a little bit different than what it is. But that's just another one there. Here we go. Another one, just smaller. You're going to start seeing these as stereos and stuff like that. And you can hear it in there also. But this is actually just a single three-quarters turn potentiometer. It's a variable resistor.
That's basically
not an on-off switch. With a variable resistance. Now, you can get them with an on-off switch, which if you ever felt those, you go click, and then you turn it up, and turn it down, click, and turn it off, right? Now, those are the same things, except for they just, where that wiper comes to the very end, you would actually go to an area that doesn't have any wire, so it literally disconnected itself. That's why you hear this little click, because you had to move it to that other area. It's very physical. It's very physical. Now, this is a newer style, which we use quite a bit, and you can really hear the, you can hear it's real fine, wiring in there is very fine. The big thing about these potentiometers in that degree is that they can't handle a lot of power. Remember I told you about pushing against something? Well, they're made, like that big one, they're not made to really dissipate heat. They're made to adjust certain things and be, make resistances to a finite area. In respect to something like this, this is a little potentiometer also. Yeah, this little guy here, a little 10-turn potentiometer. And if you take your finger now, you can just feel that you can just turn that thing. Once it reaches the end, though, it's going to stop. Don't try to go any further. You're either going to break your fingernail, or what you'll do is that you'll literally break the inside of this thing because it's fine. This we call this a trimmer, and this trimmer, again, see how small it is. You're not going to put 1,000 watts on this thing. You're not going to put 1 watt on this thing because you'll burn it up. It's plastic. Okay? So this little trimmer, we use those extensively for a lot of different things. But just another thing out there, like a resistor, all right? And we're going to talk more and more about these resistors for next week. We have capacitors, and capacitors, resistors, one of the things, my trademark kind of thing, I always say, it's different, but it's the same. You're going to hear that over and over again, you can hear, well, it's different, but it's the same. And the reason why I say it is because we use certain things, right? To drive a Ford is different than a Chevy. They got different controls, but it's the same, right? You get in, you start it up, it moves on the road, right? You have combustion engines, and away you go. So it's different, but the same. You know, it's a Dodge versus a Chevy versus a Ford versus a Toyota. They're different cars, but they're the same, right? You do the same thing in each one of them. So it's not anything different, it's just that they have different controls in different areas. And the same thing here with the capacitor and an inductor. I'm going to talk about that inductor in just a moment. But in a capacitor, you're going to see capacitors in these different formats. Very typical in some of what we do here. You're going to see them in a format that looks like one of these little guys here, okay? You're gonna see them like this, this electrolytic capacitor. It's a little different than what you're gonna see in some of them because this electrolytic is a radial lead. It is polarized. Don't worry about, but all that means is that there is a definite positive, a definite negative spot on this. And if you were to put it, the voltage, like this one here, this brown one, you're gonna see marked. It's got a positive one side and a negative on the other side. Some capacitors are not polarized. Like micas, they really don't care because they're just foil. It doesn't matter. But if it's polarized on here, and you put it in backwards, either it will not work 100% at all, or it'll blow up. Okay? And I'll tell you what, blowing things up, for some of you, you've heard that's kind of cool to do, especially with electronics. But when you're expecting something to work and you put it in backwards and it blows up in your face again, you're kind of upset. And so I've done some of these capacitor blow-ups for you. If you look on my YouTube account underneath AC7RF, which is my ham radio call. I have something called a popcorn experiment, and that's on YouTube, and where I've actually taken one just like this and blown it up for you. And I did it when nobody else was around, and I did it early in the morning, about 5 o'clock, and nobody was around, so when I was blowing stuff up, if I popped a circuit breaker, it wasn't going to be such a big issue. I never did, but it was kind of fun.
Did you say we weren't supposed to work alone?
I wasn't here alone. I summoned in a tech shop, but I was here during the summer. We get here real early, so we get out of here early. So capacitors, huh?
What's the username?
AC7RF. AC7RF. That's the other. That's a private, my own personal one. Okay. So I put a lot of things on there which are not really related to the class, but are related to cool stuff, like my rocket launches and stuff like that. Big rocket launches this weekend by Sheridan. If you want to go see some really cool stuff, if you get young kids or if you're just interested in rockets, Sheridan outside of Perrydale, head out that way. We're going to be doing some big engines. I think I'm going to buy my I engine and I'm going to do it. So I've got some big rockets. I don't have the biggest rockets out there. Some of those guys are kind of monsters. So here's another one. If you notice that this will also tell you on this thing 40 microfarads at 150 volts DC. It says 150 DC. You put 200 volts DC on this thing, it probably won't last very long. You reverse polarize this thing, it probably will not last very long. So you gotta watch what you're trying to do with these things. So there's one there. There's a metal cam one. Here's one that's got, it's another one, so 150 microfarads, 200 volts DC. It is polarized. It looks like a cherry bomb. Okay. So that's what we have. And then all of a sudden you start getting to these other ones. Here's one that looks very much like that first one. You think it's 150 volts, this is a 30 volts. Okay, and about the same microfarads. So while we think that they're the same, they're different. And you gotta be careful that you replace the capacitor with like capacitor. Here's another one. Another one, these are a little slightly different. Again, this is 25 microvolts. This can handle, if you go between certain terminals, like this one here, if you go to this one here, 350 volts, but down here, these are 25 volts. You'll get the same capacitance, but it'll be different voltages. You'll see this one here, it's like for a motor. We actually do something called start run or start cap motor. This will be one that would be seen in there. This will handle 660 volts DC at 10 microfarad. 10 micro, that's not very much. I mean, you know, 10 micro, that's 10 times 10 to the negative 6 farads. That's not a whole bunch, but it handles 660 volts on a darn thing. So it can store a pretty good lock. Okay? It can be brought there. And one of the things that you'll see is that we actually try to store these capacitors with shorting resistors in there. Put a 1 megaohm resistor across there. If not, I could charge this up, and then I can send it to you in the mail, and you grab a hold of it, right? And basically, you'll get shocked, which is not what we're trying to do here. Right? Now, that's a fairly smaller capacitor. We get some, you know, along this size, okay? And you do the same thing here. This has got 450 volts. This is a 1.9 millifarad. Okay, so it's not that bad. It's still 1.9 millifarads. It's marked 1,900 micro, which I'll talk to you guys about capacitor world. It's really kind of ridiculous at times. They don't know how to mark their stuff, but that's what they do. Okay, we'll talk more about that. But it's a big cap. Came out of a big power supply, something out there. It's been discharged. And we also have variable ones, too. Okay, now, these are variable ones. And as you can see, the dielectric in this, and I know you don't really understand dielectrics and stuff, and that's fine right now, but this has got air dielectric, and as you see, I can adjust where the plates and how close they are together just by moving this around like this, right? And this came out of like an old stereo. We also see like this one here, a little bit more robust. When you run high power amplifiers and stuff like that, and you need something that can handle huge amounts of current or huge amounts of capacitance and voltage on this, we'll go to air core. Unfortunately, they do get dirty and nasty, and you gotta keep them clean, and cat hair gets inside there and everything else, right? But these are still widely used, especially when you're talking about high power stuff. Yeah, I've got some tubes at home which would allow me to do a 5,000 watt linear. I have not built it yet because it's not because I don't have the tubes that can handle, I just don't have all the capacitors and stuff which I need to be able to handle that type of power. So, and a little difference there. But capacitors are not all created equal. They're going to have different responses to different things. I can make a capacitor simply by taking tin foil, put in paper and tin foil. I can make a capacitor. I can take two plates of steel or whatever else and put them just like this and I can make a capacitor. It's, I mean, everything that we do here is based off some very basic stuff. Okay? A resistor is, it can be a piece of wire, right? Well, a capacitor can be two pieces of wire put next to each other like this. That forms a capacitor too. And then I could take an inductor, which is all it is wire, just like this guy here, right? This is actually an inductor wrapped around itself. So this has some inductive properties. But when you're talking about DC, it's not that big an issue, but when you're talking AC, it is. So with a capacitor, and I'm gonna give you this short and skinny on a capacitor because you're gonna learn more about these next term, and in inductors also. But in the lowdown of a capacitor is that, remember I said that a resistor resists electricity, whether it's AC or DC? A capacitor is going to block DC because it's two plates. There's no connection there, right? It's two plates. But at certain frequencies, and I'm going to disclaim that, at certain frequencies, that capacitor will pass an AC waveform. And what happens is that basically we build a charge here, repels ones over here, and allows a bigger charge to come on the other side, an opposite and equal, right? We talked about magnetism. And then all of a sudden, this changes, and then this one changes. So we can actually make that field pass through. So basically like passing the field back and forth. So AC passes by frequency, okay, and again, I'll explain that, but generally, blocks DC passes AC. In what's something different, but just the same, is that an inductor, which is a piece of wire, remember I told you this, a piece of wire wrapped around itself like that, such as a coil or something like that, and this guy here, and ferrite beads and stuff like that, so this is actually an inductor, so a roller inductor. Does just like kind of what that resistor did there, but this actually had a little finger that went on here and would short out a certain part of the coil. This is an inductor, okay? And what we can do is that this here is a wire, right? See it? You can see it's just a piece of wire. So it's going to pass DC, right? But it's going to block AC at certain frequencies. So it's exactly the opposite of what a capacitor is going to do. So here we have something that can block resistance, or block DC or AC, which is a resistor. We have something that can block DC but pass AC, which is a capacitor. And we have something that can block pass DC but block AC. We've got everything covered as far as I'm concerned. And that's really what everything's made out of. From your microprocessors, everything else, your transistors are made out of these devices. Some we have, that's what I call transistors. Okay, we can transfer stuff and we can transfer this energy. Basically, we're adjusting the diode junctions, and we'll talk about that later on down the road. But discrete devices, just like this, is what makes our world. Doesn't matter if it's your computers to your. This actually came out of a light beam machine, okay, a light beam generation machine. This is a big toroidal coil, and if you look at this thing, it says it can primary is 110 watt volts, with a secondary of 16 and a half amp, or secondary 2 is going to be 12 volts with 6 amps, secondary 3 is 27 volts with 6 amps. So they were actually using this thing for to develop a enough voltage, enough current to create a large enough simulated lightning strike for aircraft. Okay. So after they installed their radio equipment and all their navigation equipment into the Hueys or whatever they're doing down here, they actually strike the aircraft with a simulation lightning bolt. They gotta make sure it's hardened. You know, I mean, I don't know if you've ever been in a plane and had lightning around you. I'm sure, yeah, it's not fun, is it? But the last thing you want is that navigation equipment to go out, right? So, I mean, they do that here in Salem. They do that here in Salem, right there at Garmin, at the airport. They tripled their size, and they have a great big air hanger out there. One of my former students, Eric, is out there. He's actually doing some of this stuff. And the reason why we got their old one is because they built themselves a new one. They had to be able to look at it a little more scientifically. This was a really kind of scratch build system, and it's really kind of cool, but they needed something a little newer. So, inductors, and you're going to see these things all over the place. They might just be simply a wire. In fact, I'm going to be absolutely honest with you guys. The moment you have a wire, you have an inductor. And if I said a capacitor doesn't have inductance, I'd be lying to you because it has a wire on it, right? And it has something. So inductors have got capacitance, and capacitors have inductance, and they both have resistance internal. I mean, there's this world is a lot more than what it seems, but realize that because down the road, we're going to get into that. It's not going to be such a huge, but when you're designing for radio frequencies, when you're designing for high-end computer systems, one of the biggest problems, and think about this for a minute, for those guys who are really into computers, the speed of computers is really stagnated, right? 3.2 gig, okay? We're stuck at 3.2 gig, and there's a reason why we're stuck at 3. We have reached a limit as to what the speed is that we can get off the microprocessor. We've gotten down to the physical size limits that we can do right now, right, with the equipment we have. And we're trying to get smaller, and we can do smaller, but it's going to take longer to make each one. It'd be like having the difference between going out and buying yourself a Toyota Corolla or a Ford Escort off the lot, right, which is mass-produced, and going out and buying yourself a Rolls-Royce, which is hand-done, right? We can get something a lot faster than that, and I know that Tektronix built one of the world's fastest microprocessors years ago. A former student did that, and it's 45 gig or 60 gigahertz. The difference is a 4-bit microprocessor, but it was done, right? But the understanding, it was a one-shot deal. I mean, you're doing ion milling. You're literally taking a single element atom out of this line to make a line. Make sense? With a laser. Well, that takes a long time. Mass production brings costs down. If you wanted a computer system that ran at 45 gigahertz based on that type of technology, you'd probably have to wait 5 years to get it, and it'd probably cost you more than what Bill Gates is worth. You see what I'm saying? Because you're going to be spending a whole bunch of money on this thing to make it happen. So it's not that we can't do it. It's that it's manufacturably not feasible right now, not cost effective. Make sense? Okay. So when we talk about these inductors and stuff like this, it's a piece of wire. It's simply a piece of wire. And the moment we roll around itself, what happens is that as we produce a current, and we're going to talk about this more here pretty soon in the upcoming weeks, as I produce a current, right, as I walk, I'm walking, right? Nothing else is happening in this world, correct? Mm-hmm. No. I have now walked by you, and some of you probably felt the air go around me, right, as I walk by you. You go down the road, and you see the air, right, because there's nothing else in this world that matters other than us, right? There is something else out there. There's air, and we're moving it around, and dust is kicking up, right? Did I touch that dust? No, but there's something else out there. When I move an electric current down a wire, I produce a magnetic field, right? I'm actually producing a magnetic field. If anybody ever says, somebody says, I can see your aura, right? Or I can see something around you. Well, it's because we are electrochemical, and I wouldn't discount that somebody can't see certain things like that, because there are certain people who can hear certain things more than I can, who can see things that I can't. And it's just by nature, right? There's thermal imaging, which is IR, which we're emanating daily, all the time. Everything's emanating, but we don't see it. And just because we can't see it doesn't mean it's not there. Make sense? All right, so here in this field of wire, we're going to produce an electric current through it, right? Well, it builds up a magnetic field. Well, we concentrate those magnetic fields, and what happens is with an AC signal source, and we're going to, again, don't worry about it so much, it builds it up, but as soon as it builds up, that current source is reversed and trying to go the opposite direction. Well, this field goes and it tries to collapse because it's moving the opposite direction, right? So it wants to go the opposite. Well, by the time it starts to collapse, it's already reversed and gone back the other direction. So what happens, it really impedes this thing from getting an AC signal source through, right? So there's some tricks that we do, and the majority of what we do in electronics is learning how to trick you and I. Okay? And it's really important, like TV, right? TV, you see everything in TV, right? No. That frame rate is like 30 frames per second. Okay, 60 frames per second is what you want, because that way it looks real fluid, but you can see at 15. If you start seeing beep frequencies at 25, if you're walking in a room and you see the kind of flickering of lights, that's because you got two different 60 hertz signals kind of hitting each other off frequencies, and you're starting to see that. Or if you see the roll on a screen, have you ever seen that roll on the screen? That's because you got different frequencies coming in there, and you can see it. That roll on the screen is actually the refresh that's happening on that computer. Okay? But we do everything here to trick the eyes, because we are pretty slow right here. We're very fast here. We're very fast here. Our nerves, I mean, seriously, I can prove that you're faster and by far much more intelligent than most in any computer out there. Okay, you ready? I won't use that one. You ready? Okay, toss it back. Okay, toss it back. Now, he had no idea, other than what we had set up before, how much these weighed, what they were going to be like, where they're going to come to him at, how many millions of billions of calculations did his brain have to do to catch both of those things. And if I toss them both at him, he'd try to catch both of them at one time, right? Ask a computer to do that. Ask a robot to do that right now. We don't have it. It can simulate it, and it can think about it, but that type of a calculation, right? Right?
That was quick.
Okay? It's, and I could change up, I could throw keys, right? Which are going like this, and everything else, right? All those calculations that have to go by in our brain, don't discount yourself at all, ever. This is extremely powerful, extremely powerful. What's different is that we have the same problem that computer motherboards, our computer systems have right now. Remember I told you about the processing power of those computers are so immense and everything else? The gains in the computer industry has not been, and it's going to relate back to this, guys, because I always do this full circle, does not relate back to the microprocessor, but to the motherboard manufacturing. Our eyes, our hands, are the slowest things that we have, right? Our hearing, you know, is pretty good, but our eyes are the slowest things we have. So what we're going to try to do is, the motherboard is the slowest thing on that computer system. And the gains in the computer world has been in motherboard design. Because frequency, the length of wire on that motherboard, remember I told you that length of wire has inductance, right? And what happens when I increase the inductance? What happens to frequency? I've already kind of said this now. It starts to impede it, right? It's bad for AC. So you want the smallest that you can get in the shortest runs to reduce the amount of inductance, which impedes your signal. Well, if your signal is impeded, you're not going to get as fast a system, right? So therefore, the greatest gains in computer technology in the recent years has been motherboard technology, and based on wires and how you wrap things and everything else, right? We start talking about like front side buses of, you know, I remember front side buses of 12 megahertz, bus systems, and you know, old ISA. And then we go to 66 and everything, and that's awesome with PCI, and it works really well. Well, when they start talking about, I got 200 megahertz front side bus, they really don't at that time. They're doing something called quad pumping, and now we're starting to see real systems, and there's still even a 1000 or 1 gig front side bus, not 1 gig front side bus, it's actually a quad pumped system. Don't worry about it, what I mean by that, but it's a fallacy still. You're not running that full speed. Instead, I can do two things. Either I can make everybody on highway on I-5 be able to do 100 miles an hour, right, instead of 50 miles an hour, or I can do what? I can add another whole set of lanes, right? I can do two things to increase the amount of people to get to Portland. Either double the lanes or double the speed. Well, what are we doing now? We're doubling lanes, right? And we're doubling lanes, we're doubling lanes, we're doubling, and that's what we're doing here. Okay, and we're making more efficient use, because there's a little bit of space in between there, And if during the time, which everybody is in over here, if they can slide over a little bit and slide back and slide in and slide out, then I could make better use of the whole system, right? So computer systems are as much about tricking themselves as they are about tricking us, but it's awesome. Okay. Did it make some sense on it? So thing is, then we have these really cool things, they're called transformers. No, they're not Autobots. Optimus Prime, for some of you. Wait a minute, that's you know, I remember when it was a cartoon on Saturday mornings. My little brother would have to watch it, you know? Then he got into Insectoids. As far as none of you guys ever saw Insectoids. But kind of the same things. And if Vern ever watches this, Insectoids, I still have them. I have your Insectoids, Vern. Yeah, I kept it for him because I don't think he wants anybody ever to know that he actually played with Insectoids. All right. Kind of like with some of us and Teletubbies, right? Just keep your head down. Now, all right. He's laughing. All right. So here's a transformer. This is an isolation transformer. I'll let you know, I'm not trying to make it sound loud, but okay, that's rubber feet on the bottom of that thing. This thing probably weighs about 15 pounds. Your initial power supplies and everything else that we used to use in computer systems and TVs, we had these transformers. And if we want to take one energy form, such as 120 volts, and convert it to 12 volts or whatever else, one of the simplest ways of doing it is to use a transformer. And all it is two wires brought together like this. They're isolated from each other, but remember I told you that as we produce current in one thing, we produce a magnetic field, right? What happens is when I produce that magnetic field, if there's another wire nearby it, that magnetic field cuts into that other wire and it produces a current, right? So that's why we take two wires, we'll wrap them together like this, and that as I produce that magnetic field, I can actually transform the energy from here into another voltage, another source over here. Now, there's efficiency ratings and everything else. These things are not very efficient. If you ever tried lifting one of those old TVs and anything else like that, you know that they're heavy, right? And they have a lot of heat. It's because they lose a lot in that conversion process. They lose a lot in that conversion process, which is unfortunate because, I mean, it's like, this to me is like a semi-truck, okay? And in a lot of things that we drive around, we've got these nice Toyota Corollas, or we've got our Lexuses, or wherever we've got these nice cars, computer systems, blah, 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 right? And you can get around just fine in those power supplies, okay? The new switching power supplies are awesome. But man, you know, you take that Toyota Corolla, or you take anything like that, and let's hook up a trailer to it. And we're moving to Florida, you know, we're going to head down there, so we got a 2,600 pound trailer, which isn't very heavy, and we're going to pop on the back of that little four banger, and we're going to head down the road. We'll probably get outside of Salem, we're probably going to get down, maybe into the Dalles, before that little engine's just going, and it's going to be freaking on us, right? It's going to be freaking on us. And make it further. You may get in Ontario, Oregon, and all of a sudden that's where you don't live for the rest of your life because your car is broken down because you just blew the engine up, right? And that's what happens with these switching power supplies. A lot of them are going to work just fine, you know, in a lot of things, such as like when we do computer systems, we have 400 watt switching power supplies. And then I buy a 1,000 watt for a lady when I was doing her computer build one time. Did she really need 1,000 watts? No, she was only going to really be pulling about 250, maybe 300 watts any given time. But the power supply is never going to go bad. Well, it would. But the thing is, I'm not even utilizing hardly any of this power supply, right? Now, that's like taking that semi-truck, okay, and I put that 1,200 pound or 2,600 pound trailer behind it. It's not even going to feel it, right? It's just going to cruise right down the road. I mean, it's like, oh, you mean I got to pull over the way station because there's something behind me? Oh, okay. You know what I'm saying? This is this bad boy here. It's going to take the abuse. It's going to take it. But your trade-offs are, doesn't get as good fuel economy. It's wasteful. It's heavy. You know, how would you like to carry that around in your backpack as part of your power supply? right? We'd all be bulked up and like, you know, walking around like this all the time, right? Because your back would be like that. But then your computer system would probably weigh about 180 pounds itself. Oh God, okay? So it's not very efficient, but the thing is, it's extremely basic and we still use them for transferring energy. In fact, if you look at your home, right? And some of you guys live in like a subdivision or something like that, and there's these green boxes out front. You know what I'm saying? And you go up to her, and what do? You can, lots of 60 hertz, huh? Okay. And that's a big transformer in there. And it's taking 10,000 volts or 7,500 volts line voltage and converting it to the voltages for your homes. And it's something called maximum power transfer. And that's how we do it. I mean, look at those power lines coming down I-5, right? You know, they're good sized power lines. But wait a minute, there's a power line coming in to feed, you know, there's a couple of them, yes, I know. But still, think about it. There's just those many power lines coming in to feed Salem. How in the world are we getting that much energy to light up this room, to light up hundreds of homes, thousands of homes, businesses on just those wires? Think about it. That's a lot of current. I mean, we're using current all the time, right? So how do we do it? Well, that there, we push over 100,000 volts. Okay? 100,000 volts, and let's say we pushed 100 amps. Okay? Your circuit breaker at home normally is a 200 or 300 amp supply. But it's 120 volts. So we use it. So it's transformers, okay? The big things outside your home that have PCB or actually oil now on them, right, outside of the telephone pole sometimes. Come in, we step it down, but every single time we step it down, what happens to the current capability? It goes up, and we'll learn about that here momentarily. But as I step down the voltage, I can increase the current. So now I can get down from 100,000 volts down to 120 volts, but the current capability is huge, so therefore I can feed you. That's why we do it. Okay? That's why we do it. So there's some trade-offs, and we'll talk about power and everything else, you know, momentarily in class. But it's amazing. Once you start seeing that, you go like, that's how that works. I'll guarantee you, after you have this one class, you'll have enough knowledge to make money. There's stuff in this class that people are like, I mean, that's how it works? Wow. Okay. I can start making money. You could. You know, every single class, I feel that you have a new avenue to build and make some money. I wouldn't say that you really should go out there and do it because there's always those little nuances that you don't know that could crop up. I had a couple of years ago, I had a gentleman come in here and he was all saying, I have this problem at work and I don't understand what's happening. And the thing is, I had just started teaching this thing called inductive kick on relays. And he was saying this solenoid was giving problems. I couldn't understand what was happening back. It was ruining their drivers and stuff like this. And I looked at my students out there. They're out there, and there's about 8 of them out there. And I said, okay, who wants a free lunch? The guys look at me like that's not what I offered. You know, I just want an answer. I said, you know, these guys have been here for 2 years, and they understand what your problem is because they've invested 2 years into this program. So who wants a free lunch? I have four guys. I said, okay. So he's going to take you to lunch, and you guys can explain to him what's going on, and you can just give him a possible answer on how to fix it. The four guys took off with this guy. He bought him lunch. They sat down and said, you need to put a capacitor in there. Really? They said, you need to put a capacitor, but they said, you recommend you put a diode, blah, blah, blah. It's an inductive kick. It was an issue. It was killed. It took them 2 seconds to tell them what the answer was because they understood they had just done a lab in this thing. Okay, the week before, they had just done a lab. Yeah. It was awesome because the next year, that guy enrolled in our program because he realized what it cost him. It was nothing in comparison to the knowledge which they had. So understand that you guys are going to keep on moving forward in this and you're going to get a lot of knowledge. Guaranteed, 100%. You'll become very dangerous. Very dangerous. Highly dangerous. All right. So passive components, we see those with transistors and integrated circuits out there. And the transistorized systems, again, that's an active device. It requires energy to make it work. It's going to require energy to really make it work. Your passive devices that you do, and resistors, capacitors, and inductors, they're just going to function as a function of the energy that's going through them. That's it. A transistor, for it to work, you have to supply power to make it work in itself. Same thing with an integrated circuit. There are certain specialty chips, like some of the radar jamming systems, which can self-generate a voltage based on the amount of radar signal coming in. It happens. We can do it. I mean, you're being bombarded by microwaves and cell systems, right? RF daily, hourly, minutely, by the second, right? Well, I could take a piece of wire and a capacitor and an inductor, and if I'm really good, I can even make myself my own little speaker, and I have a radio. I don't need a power source, and I can listen to the radio. How am I going to generate power? Well, that magnetic field, right? It's a magnetic field, is bombarding. And what happens when that magnetic field cuts the wire? It produces an electricity, right? So I'm going to use it itself to power my own circuit. So I'm getting free power in many ways. But at the same time, it's not real high fidelity. It doesn't sound really good at times. And you got to stand in the right direction, and you got to hold your hand up like this. But that's how you do it. My the students who take my telecom class, ends and takes in telecom, antennas and transmission lines, one of their projects, they have to build a field strength meter. And that field strength meter is basically defined. Have you guys ever heard of like fox and hound or bunny hunts or transmitter locating, or when the black box goes down or when the aircraft goes down, they got to locate it, or tracking animals, right, because they got a radio collar on there? Well, that's a field strength meter, or actually a meter that they're going to be utilizing. The students actually design their own, and they have to find me on campus somewhere. Okay? But they're taking that magnetic field that I'm producing, right, or radio field, and they're having to amplify it and have to.